And so we have grown older, hopefully wiser, and lovely to see Pastor Jacob also here, and some other friends, and new faces is wonderful. One of Shakespeare's comedies, I'll manage with this, okay? Let this be. I'll do with this. One of Shakespeare's comedies had this very interesting title, The Taming of the Shrew. Some of us are familiar with that. You know, in that story, the shrew, by the way, not a nice name, it's a name of a kind of mouse-like animal to give to a woman, not a very nice thing. But Katharina, who has a very sharp, offensive tongue, is called a shrew in this story. And she is tamed with all sorts of psychologically humiliating games. We are here in the 16th century, at the end of the 16th century, very patriarchal society, and so this is the story. But this morning, I want to speak about the taming of the shrewd. Which person stands out in our mind when we think of being a shrewd person? Yes, we've already been told the topic of today's study. A guy called Jacob, the shrewd one. And we find this story in the first book of the Old Testament. Jacob, the shrewd one. How does God tame the shrewd? My name is Jacob too. I remember years ago when my daughter was maybe 3 or 4 and I was trying to explain to her, her name is Priyanka, and I was trying to explain to her the meaning of her name. So I explained to her, I said, darling, your name means the beloved one. We love you. She turned around and asked me, daddy, what is the meaning of your name? And so I said, I smiled and I said, heel grasper. Actually, that's the meaning of Jacob, the one who holds the heel, heel grasper. She didn't get that. What is that? I said, deceiver. I smiled and I said, deceiver. She didn't get that. Then I said, crook, the crook. She didn't get that either. So then I said, a bad man. And then she was shocked. She said, why did your parents give you that name? Now, as it is the custom in some families, you get the name of your grandfather. And my grandfather's name was Chaco. But I was born in the north, where, you know, very often your Chaco will become a Chaku. And the Chaku means a little dagger, okay? And so my father thought that it was better that I have the anglicized version of Chaco, and I became Jacob. How does God deal with a shrewd person? Listen carefully, because this could be our story too. When you think of Jacob, can you tell me one good thing that he did? Because God calls himself the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. Tell me one good thing that he did. Come on. If I asked you about Abraham, you may be ready with a couple of things. Tell me one good thing that Jacob did that we must clap for. Come on. Anybody wants to try? Persevering? In a very cunning way, right? So persevering, okay? All right. He reconciled? Okay, we're going to look at the story. Okay. He reconciled. Okay, we'll see. Who reconciled? We'll see. Good? Okay. Any other? Nothing stands out in your mind? Come on. Jacob. Sorry? You said, okay, he fought with God and he said? Okay. And that was by choice? That did that fight take care because he wanted to fight with God? Okay. Yeah, he wanted blessings. That's what he wanted. That's all what we want also, blessings. Ha, 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 ha. But interestingly, Jacob, do you know, gets into the faith chapter in the New Testament. Which is the faith chapter in the New Testament? Hebrews chapter 11 is often called the faith chapter. Why would he be mentioned in the faith chapter, anyone? Any guess? How can Jacob enter the faith chapter along with David and Abraham and people like that? How would he enter? What is the great faith stuff that he did? Well, look in your Bibles, Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 21. I would like one of you to read. Hebrews 11, 21. Anyone who finds it. Okay. This act, when he was dying, he blessed each of Joseph's, that is his son's, sons, and he worshipped as he leaned on top of his staff. How does an act of blessing your grandchildren become an act of faith? How does that become an act of faith? I mean, grandparents are forever ready to bless the grandchildren. Yesterday, my son went to school for an exam, and my mother comes into the room and puts her hand on him and blesses him to make up for the studies he did not do. Blessing your grandchildren, how does that become an act of faith? Well, for that, we have to go through this quickly, very quickly, through the story of Jacob. Come with me to the book of Genesis, and we begin the story in Genesis chapter 25. Quickly with me. I hope your Bibles are with you. If you have, please follow with me as we look at the text here. Genesis 25, Jacob. And the birth of Jacob is talked about. Jacob and his twin brother Esau, or rather Esau and his twin brother Jacob. And we read in verse 19 and 20 that Isaac was how many years old? 40 years old. Okay.
Shall I try this?
All right. Okay. Isaac is 40 years old. And he marries Rebekah. Verse 21. Isaac prayed to the Lord on behalf of his wife because she was childless. Interesting. Do you remember Abraham, the man God calls to make him the father of the nations, but he doesn't have children easily. Now his son Isaac, he is married, and he has to be the person who brings in the blessings of God, and they don't have children either. And then finally, of course, the twins are born. But look at verse 26, the last part. How old was Isaac when Rebekah gave birth to the boys? 60 years. So how many years did they have to wait? 20 years. 20 years of barrenness. And especially in that culture, this is horrible. It's a tragedy. Why does God, when he wants to bless people and make them a nation, why can't he choose a fertile woman, a woman from India for sure, you know? Or how come God chooses people who are having difficulty having children and he wants to make them a nation? Interesting. And so we have God chooses people with difficulties, perhaps to remind all of us that God is in charge and not human beings. Only he can fulfill his purposes. So we know the story. Jacob is born, and when he comes out, he's holding on to the heel of his brother. And in the Hebrew, it is Yaakov, which means the heel grasper, which metaphorically means deceiver. Okay? That's not a name we would choose if it was the name that we had in English. What's your name? Heel Grasper. And now we have the heel grasper born. How would you like to have a brother called Jacob? You know, in this little book, a compilation of children's letters to God, this is what one of the boys wrote to God. Thank you, God, for my baby brother. But if you remember, I had actually asked for a puppy. I didn't really want a baby brother. And if you were a boy, you surely didn't want a baby brother called Jacob. The first thing I want you to remember is Jacob is a crook. What's your name? Mr. Crook. But the interesting thing is, he is God's crook. Now that's the way the Bible portrays him. There's no whitewashing that image or soft peddling his true nature. He is a crook, but he's God's crook. Now you may say, that's an amazing incongruence. That's what it is, and that's why it is called amazing grace. God being active in the life of a crook, of a schemer. But the interesting thing about this crook is he's really smart. He always makes it. Look at chapter 25, verses 27 and 28. Quickly, the boys grew up and Esau became a skillful hunter, a man of the open country, while Jacob was content to stay at home among the tents. Looks like he's a very nice, quiet chap, staying quietly at home. But what is he doing sitting in those tents? He's planning. Scheming. He is quiet, but he's not soft. He manages to cheat his brother. That's the next story. We don't have time to read that story. And by the way, you soon realize in the story that this is a dysfunctional family. A very dysfunctional family. Maybe some of us have been very privileged to come from very wonderful families where we never heard our mother and father shout at each other, where we've never struggled. Now maybe there are a few of us who come from that. But you know, the majority of people in the world come from real families where there are real problems, and some of us have those kind of real families. But the interesting thing is, God can work in real families. And Jacob comes from such a dysfunctional family where one parent is more leaning towards one of the children and the other to the others. But this crook knows how to manipulate things in this dysfunctional family. He cheats his brother, and with the help of his mother, he even cheats his father. Chapter 27, we are going quickly through this. And when he had cheated his father, could not see, my father, 87 years old, is now staying with us. He can't see very well. Sometimes somebody walks in, he wonders who it is. And he cheats his father to get the blessings of the firstborn. You see, in that culture, you had to be the firstborn to receive the blessings of God. And so he went after it in all ways, and he got it. But then we read in chapter 27 and verse 41, when Isaac dies, Esau held a grudge against Jacob because of the blessing his father had given him. He said to himself, the days of mourning for my father are near. I will not do anything till that time. But then I will, what does it say? Kill my brother Jacob. I will kill him. But I'll just wait. Let the formal days of mourning be over. I will kill him. So what happens? Jacob runs away. Jacob is not a fighter. He's a crook. A clever one, but he knows when to run away, and so he runs away. His mother is there to help him, of course, and so he runs away. As he's running from home, chapter 28, God steps into his life. And how does that happen? One night he has to stop somewhere, and as he stops there, he has an interesting dream. Chapter 28. And in the dream, what does he say? What does he see? All of us in Sunday school, we learned this, right? Jacob's ladder, or the success ladder for many people. And what happens in that? Please notice, God says this, I am the Lord. Chapter 28 and verse 13. 28 and 13. The Lord stood and said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham, the God of Isaac, and I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you, and I will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land, and I will not leave you until I have done what I promised you. Pray tell me, why would God want to do this? Why would God say, I'm going to bless you, I'm going to do this for you, I'm going to make you a blessing to the whole world? Like, what has he done to deserve this? Isaac had blessed him, so God had to. Because of his covenant to Abraham. What did Jacob do to deserve this? Please tell me. Nothing. If you read this promise of God, it's an unconditional blessing. It doesn't say, if you are a nice boy, I will bless you. That's what we tell our children, you know. You study nicely, I will give you this gift. If you come in the top 10 in the class, I will, you know. God has no conditions. He's telling a crook, I'm going to bless you. But then, you know, read what Jacob speaks to God. Jacob, verse 20, made a vow saying to God, if, he starts with an if, speaking to God. If you, God, will be with me, and if you will watch over me on this journey I'm taking, and if you will give me food to eat and clothes to wear, if you do all those nice things for me, so that I return safely to my father's household, then you will be my God. And then this stone that I have set up as a pillar, oh, I'll make this God's house. And not only that, of everything you give me, I will give you a tithe, 10% back. What a wonderful arrangement. If I come to Sujit this morning, Sujit, I have a wonderful offer to you. Every 1,000 rupees you give me, I will give you 100 back. How do you like it? And he will clap his hands and say, what a smart crook you are. Do you notice that when God promised him, it was unconditional, but when Jacob spoke to God, it was, God, if you do this, and if you do this, and if you do this, I don't mind having you as my God. You see, Jacob basically is a person who will manipulate anybody and everybody, including God. And some of us, when we have this relationship with God, think we can even manipulate God somehow. Maybe arm twist him little by being a little more religious, or being fasting a little bit, or, you know, I'm being nice now, God. Can you be also nice to me? Jacob, the consummate deal maker, strikes a bargain with God. Of course, when he strikes that bargain, you know who's on the benefiting end. Instead of receiving grace, you see, when God gives him an unconditional promise, it's grace. Jacob does not understand grace yet. He strikes an advantageous business deal with God. And then in chapter 29, we read the story of Jacob goes to live with his uncle. What's his name? Yes, Laban. And there he likes his daughters, and he says, one of them at least to begin with. And then he works for those wives of his. and he becomes, you know, his uncle becomes his father-in-law. And again, while he's with his uncle, he's grabbing and grasping. Poor Laban, he thought he was smart. He had not met his son-in-law yet. And very soon, well, what do you expect if your son-in-law is called Mr. Crook? But his wife, Rachel, is also quite an expert liar, if you read the story carefully. And then, after some years, Jacob is now running away from his father-in-law, running away with a lot of his property. And Laban is also coming after him to finish him off. But it's interesting, in chapter 31, it's not because Jacob was too clever. In chapter 31, verse 24, God comes to Laban in a dream and says, be careful not to say anything to Jacob, either good or bad. In other words, God restrains Laban, otherwise he would have finished him off. Now, how do you say something to somebody, neither good nor bad? And so we have this Jacob, the self-made man, the successful man. He has made it big at home, and he has made it big abroad. He's a successful millionaire. Success story, that's the one, his face will come on the covers of your magazines. He can handle any situation himself, and he has made it in life. Just a few weeks ago, I happened to watch a bit of a TV serial where these young executives had to prove that they were the best to be hired by this other guy. And finally, the one who won it, he kept saying, I am a self-made man. He said that. He actually said it. I'm a self-made man. I don't know how you make yourself, but some people are self-made. Jacob was one of them. Self-made man. But you know something? Jacob does not know anything about blessing yet. He thinks he knows what blessing is all about. He has not yet seen the blessed life. Is there a Jacob lurking in our lives? Are we also tempted to run our own lives? We are very clever, you know, and we don't, you know, when people ask us, how are you doing? Usually many religious, spiritual Christians like me would say, by the grace of God, we are doing well. But give me 5 minutes, I will tell you how smart I am. Jacob, God's crook. The second phase of his life, which is really important here, is when he's running away from Laban, he comes to chapter 32. He comes to a very interesting place. Chapter 32, where we all know that story of wrestles with God. And when does that happen? It happens in chapter 32 when he has to go back through the place where now his brother lives. And so in chapter 32, he told his messengers, tell Esau I'm coming through. And verse 6, 32:6. When the messengers returned to Jacob, they said, we went to your brother Esau, and now he is coming to meet you, and what? 400 men are with him. The last he had any connection with Esau was he ran away from him, knowing Esau said, I will kill him. I'm just waiting for the days of mourning to be over. Now, after some years, he comes back, and Esau is coming to meet him with 400 men. Jacob cannot fight those 400 men. What's he going to do? Well, he's a smart cookie, isn't he? After all, his name is Jacob. So what does he do? He plans. First thing he says is, okay, let me divide my family. Because if he attacks this, maybe this one will escape. Maybe I'll be the lucky one, I'll also escape. But along with that, he does something else. He says, maybe I will buy him off. And so in verses 13 onwards, he decides a list of gifts, not one gift. Please read from verse 13 to 16. There are 500 plus animals that he's going to give him. Goats, camels, ewes, cows, bulls, female donkeys, male donkeys. They're also not all together. One after another. Here is 20 donkeys. Here is one after. So that he will be floored by the time he receives all these gifts. And then, okay, I will be safe. But you know something? He does something, one more thing, very interesting in verse 9. He plans everything, but he does something interesting in verse 9. What does he do? He prays. Oh, that helps. Praying, right? That doesn't always come the first thing to do, right? But he prayed and said, God, please, you know, I've been a kind of a good guy. I'm not really that worthy, but neither am I so unworthy. But you've been nice to me. Thank you very much. And please save my life and my skin. God says, don't worry. This is one planned meeting that you didn't plan. I'm going to plan something. And so in chapter 32, verse 22 onwards, Jacob is alone at a creek called the Yabok. Yabok, the creek. Just to play on words and the sound of words, the crook comes to God's creek. Actually, in the Hebrew, there is a play in Yaakov and Yabaka, the same three letters. Just there are three letters in the Hebrew. Not did I say Greek? Hebrew. And Jacob and Jabok have the same three Hebrew letters. It seems like there's a play there in the text. Jacobs must come to their Jaboks. Then only they will be blessed. But what happens here? Here, this is something he did not plan. It says here that there was a man who wrestled with him till daybreak. So it's dark, he can't see very well, and this man is wrestling with him, and Jacob is wrestling with him. And the wrestling is something that epitomizes the life of this Jacob. This fight in the night is epitomizes what Jacob has always been. Basically fighting with everybody to get what he wants. Now I like to imagine this, that this person or figure who's fighting with Jacob, if I was there and in the night I can't see who this guy is, and he's fighting with me, and I feel him, he's skinnier than me. He's just skin. He's kind of tough, but he's skinny. And I say, hey man, this guy is skinny, I can handle him. And I fight with him, and I fight, but I'm not able to put him down. I thought I was stronger than this guy, but this guy is okay. And then, guess what? Daybreak comes and I see his face. He's a skinny guy, but he's Bruce Lee. Now, some of you don't know what Bruce Lee is, that's all right. You know, I got educated with people like Bruce Lee. Bruce Lee does not have to fight the whole night with me. Neither does this figure have to fight the whole night with Jacob. It's just God allowing him to fight. And then when the time comes, okay, one touch, poop, I too, finished. The hip is out of joint. Now he cannot fight anymore. But then he suddenly says something. He realizes this is something more than I have handled. The crook is now a cripple. And that's when he says, I won't let you go. He says, what's your name? My name is Crook. He says, your name is going to be Israel. He said, please bless me. And what did he say? I'm giving you a brand new Bugatti or Mercedes-Benz or you know, a villa in some place. I'm going to give you some more wives and children and donkeys and camels. You know, even believers, very often our language of blessing is always connected to material things. Oh, pastor, please come to our house and pray. God blessed us with a new house, and you know, and so if you please come and pray. The kind of language we always use, blessing is always connected to material things. But here, please note, nothing new has been added to Jacob's life, but he is now learning what is true blessedness. He has a new name, and he has a new nature. And now he is ready to meet his brother. No, he doesn't reconcile with him, but let's look at it. Jacob, God's crook. Jacob comes to God's creek, and Jacob is now God's cripple. And he is beginning to learn that as Israel, you get ahead in life, in God's ways, only with God's blessing and God's face. A wonderful writer has called this the magnificent defeat. The place when you are defeated so that you are blessed. Jacob is defeated by the mere brush of the divine hand. And he limped. The rest of his life he limped as a reminder that the greatest things in life in the kingdom of God do not come with our very smart efforts, but through the grace of God. And so now he's ready. Chapter 33, he's ready to meet Esau. How is he ready? He has been crippled by grace. And now he's coming towards Esau. He can see Esau coming, and so he starts bowing down to Esau. Verse 4, and Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him. What? Excuse me? What did Esau say? I will finish him off. Many years ago, he has never seen him after that. Now he's running towards Jacob and embracing him and kissed him. Maybe this is all a drama. Maybe he's going to embrace him and kiss him and then say, excuse me, what did you think? I had forgotten. Now let us start the drama. You know, that's the kind of thing that becomes legend in movies, the unexpected and the little drama. I still remember the legendary Hindi movie Shole. Some of you have seen that. And there's that scene when Gabbar Singh, the name that is supposed to bring terror into the lives of people, and he sends those three fellows out to catch they come back empty-handed. And now they are standing before him. So what does he say? What does he do? He takes his little gun with 6 bullets. Remember that? Some of you are not very worldly people, or your memories are not seen this. This is a nice scene to see. He takes off 3 bullets. So there are only now 3? How many of you remember that? Few of you. Okay. And there are 3 bullets. Then he says, "Hum isko ghumayegi." And he just turns it so that he doesn't know where the bullets are. He's a smart guy. And then he points the one towards the one guy. Click! Nothing happens. Oh! He's relieved. He's safe. He turns to the other guy. Click! Ooh! He's safe too. And he turns to the third one. Click! Oh, those were the empty ones. And then they all start laughing. And they say, "Oh! Wonderful!" Oh, they laugh. And then he turns around, finishes them off. Maybe Esau is going to do something like this. He's going to come and hug him and kiss him and say, "Oh, my brother." But this is all a drama. Or is it? Jacob doesn't believe this. He doesn't understand what's happening. He says, "Is this real?" Or is this a little drama? But then he feels real tears. He cannot believe that Esau has been so gracious to him. Would Jacob have been so gracious to Esau? This is when he realizes, this is not my smarts. This is not what I have done. And then he begins to speak to him and says, who are these children? Esau says, oh, he says, these are the children whom God has graciously given to me. He's beginning to recognize grace now. And so finally, quickly, my time is going. Jacob is learning the language of God dependency, of grace. And he makes an altar. Verse 20, mighty is the God of Israel. But let's come quickly. We turn a few chapters. We move quite a bit to the story of Jacob and Joseph and all that story that happens. And finally, Joseph is in Egypt. Joseph is doing well. And now old man Jacob is staying with his son, Joseph, who has a very important position in Egypt. But he can't see now. He's kind of blind. And finally, time comes for him to die. And now he has to bless his grandchildren. Chapter 48, Genesis 48. We read that Joseph now brings his two sons to be blessed by Jacob. As is customary in the culture, the senior boy, the elder boy, gets the bigger blessing. And who's the older boy? Manasseh. And the younger boy is Ephraim. So, since Jacob can't see very well, Joseph brings the two boys to him, and he makes sure that the older boy is standing so that the right hand of Jacob comes here, and the younger boy is standing so that the left hand of Jacob will come like this, and he has set it up. Now, when he begins to do this, in verse 17 and 20, when Joseph saw his father placing his right hand on Ephraim's head, he was displeased. Joseph, our hero, by the way, Joseph, he's unhappy. And he took hold of his father's hand to move it from Ephraim's head to Manasseh's head. After all, isn't that the way things should be done? And he says, no, my father, this one is the firstborn. Put your right hand on his head. But his father refused and said, I know, my son, I know. He too will become a people and he too will become great. Nevertheless, his younger brother will be greater than him. You know what? Jacob is not confused as an old man. He knows fully well what is happening. But he has also learned a lesson. It is not being the firstborn that matters with God. When God wants to do his purposes, fulfill his purposes, it is not what we are born with that makes a difference. It's not our opportunities that necessarily makes a difference. It is God's grace that is genuinely received and acted upon. He realizes that you can get ahead in life, in the kingdom, in the world. Yes, you get ahead by being smart and clever and crooked. But you see, Jacob is a crippled crook. He has been crippled by grace. It's only when you and I are crippled by God's grace that our strength is broken, that we genuinely realize it is in the strength of God that we go ahead. Have you been crippled by grace? Have I been crippled by grace? Isaiah chapter 6, when he sees the vision of God, he says, woe unto me, I'm a man of unclean lips. When Isaiah was crippled by God, by the grace of God, by the power of God, he was ready to do what God wanted him to do. Peter, the fisherman in Luke chapter 5, when he saw that great catch of fish, what did he say? He fell on his knees and said, "Jesus, I'm sorry. I don't understand this. I am a sinful man. Please leave me alone. Please leave me alone. You should be somewhere else. I am a sinful man." Jesus said, "Now you're qualified, Peter. Now you're qualified. Come. You're ready now. Come. You can fish for people. You qualify. You can feed my sheep." The Apostle Paul, he says, "My strength is made perfect." I mean, he says about God spoke to him and said, "My strength is made perfect in your weakness." It's in dependency on God that the Holy Spirit opens up the infinite resources of God's grace. Friends, what does it take to tame a shrew? Well, Shakespeare came up with many things that seemed okay and even entertaining in his culture. But what does it take to change a shrewd man like me and you? Because whether your name is Jacob or not, there is a Jacob that lurks in each one of us. The Jacob that is only concerned with ourselves. The Jacob that wants blessings from God no matter what. The Jacob that is so far from the kingdom of God. And yet God is gracious. He doesn't leave us alone to our own devices. He steps in and he cripples us by grace. And then he calls himself, "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and the crook." But the crook needs to be crippled by God's grace. This is a hard lesson to learn in our world of ungrace. How often have you seen grace in action? Is the church a place where grace is overflowing? This world doesn't value grace. It values hard work and cleverness, and often deviousness is rewarded. But those of us who know we are privileged to be the children of God, we often and easily forget grace. But God must wound us precisely in our strengths. God must touch our hips. I want you to picture Jacob walking away into the sunset with a limp. And then we look at the cross. The cross is a symbol of human defeat, the defeat of human effort, and a reminder that we can only make it by grace. Will we allow God to cripple us by his grace so that we can fulfill God's purposes in our lives? Let us pray. Gracious Father, what an unlikely story, life of Jacob, where you teach us, followers of our Lord Jesus, that we need to live a life of grace. Allow you to teach us the lessons of grace and make us people of overflowing grace to those around us. Teach us as a church to be a place of overflowing, amazing grace to people around us and our communities. Thank you that you can pick up a person in a bad situation, in a dysfunctional family, and yet through that person, bring blessing to the whole world. Lord, you can do that with my life, with our lives. We give our lives into your hands. Make us, Lord, a blessing to many people. This is our prayer. Thank you for my sisters and brothers who are here this morning. Thank you for the children. Thank you that you have graciously given us an opportunity to think and to realign our lives and our thoughts and our intentions and our ambitions with the power of God, with the power of grace. We thank you. We give you all praise and glory. May your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.